describes autumn in beautiful words, and this description is quite uncommon, and in that prevailing trends, you know, it was not accepted, because he was using, you know, personification. Now he says in these lines, season of mist and mellow fruitfulness, close bosom friend of the maturing sun, conspiring with how to load and bless with fruit the vines that round the thatch eaves run. Now let us enter these beautiful lines and how this poet has brought in the important feature of supernaturalism. Let's try to understand this feature. Now, while talking of autumn, Keats describes autumn as a season of mist and mellow fruitfulness, because, you know, fruits have become mellower and they are ready to be ripe. So this beautiful season, he has called it to be season of mist. And going ahead, he just indicates through these words that this season is a close bosom friend of the maturing sun. Now what does it mean? That sun has matured. Sun has become mature and its color has also changed, because it is going towards summer now. It has seen winter. From winter, it changes its range now, and it is going ahead. So the maturing sun is a bosom friend of this season, that means autumn. Now if we go deep in these words, we start appreciating this fact that the natural phenomena, they fail us to have an imagination, and our mind starts thinking of some supernatural. Now this sun, he conspiring with how to load and bless. He conspires that how to load, how to fill these fruits with these fruits, how to make them mature with fruits the vines that round the thatch eaves run. And here there is a beautiful amalgamation of insects and of course the plants, because he's in the last line he says with fruit the vines, because vines will now have fruits, and around these vines what is running? The thatch eaves. So thatch eaves, they are small insects, and they are running around these vines, and these vines will have fruits, and these fruits will take place only with the union of sun with autumn. So having developing a link between all the features of this nature, because he is linking sun, the elements of nature, like sun with autumn, with thatch eaves, with vines, and all these things. So this poet is developing a very nice connection with all these elements. Now, yet another literary feature of this age that was that, you know, this poetry was like a subjective poetry. Now, subjective means that it was not objective. Subjective in the sense that it was dealing at a personal level. It was talking of human emotions and it was not concerned with the whole world. The poets of this period, in fact all the five poets, now they are not talking of the worldly phenomena. They are talking of their self. Of course, they are using different devices. Sometimes they are using imagination, persona, personifications, and so on and so forth, you know. But in common, what they are doing? In common, their poetry deals with subjectivity. And what do we mean by subjectivity? That the realities of life, these realities are objective realities, but they have developed a subjective angle towards there. So in that sense, this romantic poetry, it becomes individualistic because they are talking of their own self, and they are linking it to the world, but they are not going in the details of the world. So they have become aloof, and they are concerned about their own self only. Now, if we see these features, of course, there are plenty of poems of this age, you know, because this was a predominant feature. And whether we take the poems of Wordsworth, because when we take the poems of Wordsworth, he is known for his lyrical ballads, and of course, his autobiographical poem, that is Prelude. Now, when we talk of Prelude, because you know, in your syllabus you don't have this poem, but at your PG level you might have this. So it is an autobiographical poem by Wordsworth. Now it's a long and narrative poem where a major poet like Wordsworth, he becomes very subjective, because you know, he just imagines that he has gone to his fields, and he has shifted his farms, and the beautiful area where snow is there, where you know, the atmosphere is serene and cool, and it's very, very beautiful scenery all around. So he talks of his own self, and he's not concerned with the world. Now similarly, if we take the case of Coleridge individually, so many of his poems, they are mostly subjective, because at objective level they are not conveying anything. Now the lesser known poets, or the young poets rather, Keats and Shelley, they are more subjective. Now in this context, again if we refer back, so we again see this poem To the Night by Shelley, and how this is subjective. So the lines read, "When I arose and see the dawn, I sighed for thee. When light rode high and the dew was gone, and noon lay heavy on flower and tree, and the weary day turned to his rest, lingering like an unloved guest, I sighed for thee." Beautiful lines, of course. Now, in these lines, you see, the poet is totally subjective, because he accepts this persona, he adopts this form, I. Now, where he just tells of his own self, that he likes and loves night. So he wants to escape, and how he expresses that, he says that when I arose and saw the dawn. Now dawn means it is not sunrise. So when sun rises, and that point is called dawn, dawn. And when it sets, you know, it is called dusk, as all of you know. So he does not want the day to rise or sun to rise. In this context, you know, if we recall the poem by Donne, that famous poem, Sun Rising by Donne, a medieval poet, of course. There in that poet, that poem, Donne, who is in love with his beloved, he does not want the sun should rise. And he says, "Oh, unruly old fool." So in this poem, he does not, say in these words, but he says, "When I arose and saw the dawn," actually he should become happy that night has passed, but he loves the darkness of light. He does not like the light of the day, and he wants to escape from this light of the day to the darkness of the night. So remembering night, he says, actually he's appreciating night. So how he goes, he says, "When I arose and saw the dawn, I did not welcome the day. I sighed for thee." Thee means night. So the night has passed and the day has come. So this approaching day is like something which is unwelcomed guest, because the poet is in a subjective mood, and he says, I don't want the light of this day. So he sighs for night. When light rode high, and as the day, it progressed, so it became more and more. So light rode high, and the dew was gone, because in the morning hours, the dew is there. So when it is 7, then 8 or 9, so dew has gone. And noon lay heavy on flower and trees. And it was the time of 10 o'clock, then 11 o'clock, and the noon approached. And this noon, it was heavy on flower, on trees, and the weary day. And now this day is just passing, and this is like a wearing day. It turned to his rest, and now sun has set. And in other words, we have dusk. So lingering like an unloved guest. So Shelley, in this beautiful phrase, he says that this day was not a welcome guest. It was like an unwelcome, unloved guest, and I always wanted to remain in night only. So he says, "I sighed for thee." Now, if we talk of this variety, because we have got five major poets, and of course, we have a generation gap, because Wordsworth, he was born in 1770. At Cockermouth. In 1772, we have the birth of Coleridge. So they two were contemporary. Now, after that, in 1791, we have the birth of Shelley, and 1793, we have the birth of Keats. So Keats is the youngest, and Wordsworth is the oldest. So there is a difference of 23 years between them, and they are standing on the same platform, and that platform is that of Romanticism. But nobody is lesser important here, because if you talk of Keats has composed only a few odes, and his literary contribution is not much. He is not a voluminous writer. On the other hand, Wordsworth, he lived for 80 years, and he composed many poems, and of course he also composed this critical work also. Similarly, Coleridge, he lived for an age of 58 years. But Shelley and Keats, they were not so lucky, because Keats passed away at a young age of 26. Shelley passed away at the age of 30. So whatever little they wrote, but it is very important. And when we talk of generation gap, you know, there is a you know, profusion of variety, because we have got lot of variety in their poetry, you know. And when this poetry we discuss, you know, so we have the character and moods of different writers. So you know, there is a critic called W.J. Long. He has given one opinion that he says that we have a general impression of the previous writer, like when we talk of Alexander Pope, the age which was prior to the age of this romantic age, you know. So we have a general impression of sameness, but in the work of the best romanticism, there is endless variety. So there is no repetitiveness. What he means to say, that every time you have a new simile, new symbol, new imagery, and new kind of imaginations. So all of them excel, because Keats' images and symbols, they are quite different from the images and symbols of Wordsworth. So in that sense, we cannot compare Wordsworth images and Keats' images or Shelley's images. But what I mean to say, that if we talk in that terms, you know, the romanticism as a whole, so we have this unit, and this unit is profusion of variety, because we have so many poems, excellent poems, full of imagination, and there was a profusion of variety. And just as when we read these poets and the beautiful poems by them, so this is like, you know, passing through a village. Somebody has said that when we pass through a new village, and when we meet different kinds of people of different temperament, and we find that no person is similar to the other person. Of course,